Hello and welcome to this edition of One on One. I am Cyril Stober. My guest today is an activist with a difference. He is an advocate of peace and non-violence. His belief in advancing the cause of peace led him to found a body known as Foundation for Peace and Non-Violence in Nigeria. Well, his origin puts him in the position to appreciate the devastation that violence can wreak on the socio-political and economic life of society. He hails from River State and was raised in Port Harcourt, where he attained his education. Let's welcome Onengiya Erekosima, President and Founder, Foundation for Peace and Nonviolence in Nigeria.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Right. Good to have you on One on One.
Thank you.
Now let's begin from the very start of it, the early days. What was this thing about? What was it as you were growing up in Port Harcourt then? What captured imagination about living in a society that was peaceful? I assume that at that time things would not have been as hot as now. But tell us.
Yes, I am born into a family of six. And my younger brother died. That pushed me into really thinking about life. I got married and I have five kids. I grew up in Port Harcourt. Port Harcourt used to be so peaceful, lovely. A place where even when you carry a stick, when you're fighting with somebody, policemen are looking for you. If you carry a stick, we grew up respecting elders. We grew up in Port Harcourt like a family. Then when I go to Lagos and you're a Port Harcourt boy, you're like the heart of Nigeria. That's where Nigeria is. That's where the spirit of love, the spirit of oneness is. So we grew up with love, togetherness. We knew almost everybody in the town. That's how we grew up. But along the line, we begin to see things changing, political ways. People started asking for power instead of getting the name that would be a blessing to them. So until this Asaris thing came up, and I discovered that Asaris stood up against a system, to my understanding, it was like it was against his system. So after the Asari Ateke war and so on, I saw a man who wants to bring back disrespect. So I decided doing a photograph for him, video. I did my video for him free of charge. Asari was not paying me. I became his video man. I didn't know God was taking me through a process. Then I started understanding the differences, why they're fighting, why the harm struggle, as I was covering along the line before Asari was arrested. Now, when Asari was arrested, I was the first person he called. He called me at the police headquarters, Moscow Road, that I should come. When I went there, he gave me his phone and said, it's an arrest. Since then, I begin to understand that God has given me something to do. I have never been a militant. I have never carried a gun. I don't like the idea that somebody who is not licensed is having a gun.
Okay. So, now you say that there was a struggle, there was a fight, there was a protest against the system.
Yeah.
Now, which system are we talking about
Good.
Here?
Now, I came to understand, because at a time, the whole of the struggle is not the Adakaboro struggle. It's not the Kensedewewa struggle. This struggle became a tussle, a power tussle between groups, between rival cult groups. So it was not like they are fighting Nigeria, because I keep asking, what is this idea that we heard that the Niger Delta is fighting Nigeria? I discovered that there was nobody actually fighting Nigeria. There was no time in the history of my own understanding with what I saw, with what I heard, where people from the Niger Delta stood up and were fighting Nigeria.
Okay, so this started because you had several groups and they were struggling to get...
To be recognized. Right. Who will be recognized? At that time, you had to be strong to be recognized. You have to have boys. To be able to rig elections for people who wants to rig elections for them. So we have tussle. Then people came up. At that time, Asari was the president of the IYC, who is the Ijaw Youth Congress. And when these things came up, the people of IYC now saw that when there was a tussle between him and Ateketom and others, that there was a finger of some people in government.
Okay.
So it was from there, it was now converted to say, we're fighting the government.
Okay.
That is actual truth. Now, our elders, most of our elders, who I think does not really have a conscience, who did not understand that by the time you lay a foundation, your children will build on it. Begin to convert something that was criminality, something that was a cult war, to a struggle. Because they wanted to be relevant in Abuja, come to Aso Rock and say, we know the boys. So it all started like that. Until now, when Asari came out for negotiation between Ateketom, Obasanjo called them and gave them grace to surrender their guns. I went to Asari and I talked to him. I made Asari surrender all of his guns. All of his guns. I said, even the pistol, even this, I was following him up. I said, we will do this. The world must know that I made Asari surrender all of his guns. So when Asari was picked up, and he called me and said, they have arrested him. I gave 24 hours deadline to the police because I know what his boys are capable of doing. That we must hear from Asari if you're taking him to Abuja. When they got to Abuja, they called. And they called and I talked to Asari. The boys, the leaders, all their names, they called themselves generals, and all of them came around. We're waiting for action. When I picked the phone and I talked to Asari, at the end of the day, the order I had, because then I have been seen to be in charge, was that these boys should go to the streets. I looked at myself, how can I tell people to go to the streets? I don't know, you're throwing stone in the market, you don't know who has gone to the market. If you go to the streets, who are you going to kill? So I told them, when I dropped the phone, I said, I am told that nobody should do anything, that everything is okay, that there must be no violence from anywhere. On that day, I don't know what happened, some of them who believed that I can't get that kind of order, tore my shirt. But I stood my ground, and I moved on. 2 days after that, Lagos was burning. OPC has taken over Lagos. That's why would they arrest somebody like Asari? And that if they allowed that, that several other people would be arrested, and nobody would talk. OPC called me to Lagos. When I went to Lagos, I met with OPC, and they said they want to hold the whole town to ransom. You want to hold everybody to ransom because Asari is arrested. I want to ask you a question. I asked them, you are now Sama, you are an Igbo man, you are from Yoruba, I am from Niger Delta. If all of us are giving a gun, whom are we going to kill? You're a Christian, I'm a Muslim. If all of us are giving a gun, who are we going to kill? That question they could not answer. I told them, I know that OPC was a non-violent group from the beginning. How can we take to violence? How can we kidnap or take to ransom our own people? That the problem is not the people. The problem is the system.
Okay.
The problem was the system. And since then, after Asari was arrested, nobody asked. I didn't know God was using me. OPC has never done it. Go back to history and find out. That was how OPC went back into their houses and violence ended with OPC. That was the last period OPC ever came out to say OPC is doing anything. God used me to convert them. I told them, you cannot, because of Asari, hold your people to ransom when the system is what we have to correct. That came down. By that time, the whole place was like, nobody is moving. By the grace of God, the Asari boys, I held them down. I made sure nobody takes to violence. I told the government, look, release this man because he will create other Asaris. The government did not listen to me. I was everywhere canvassing for his release. I was the only person who had a face who could stand up and talk for Alhaji Asari Tokubo. Every other name were ghost names. We had Cynthia White, we had Ojomo Bomo. Those names were not people's names. Until we tell ourselves the truth, we cannot save this generation. This is a dying generation that we must save. I owned the Asari group until Asari was released with non-violence. The groups that went out and formed their own, those that felt they must carry violence, they must do this and break out when Asari was in prison, are the ones who most of them now have taken the amnesty thing we're talking about.
Now, you held down and there was non-violence.
Yes.
But later on, others took to the creeks.
Yes.
And they took to violence and it became widespread.
Let me tell you how it came there. The River State government at that time has handed over to Celestin Omeya. I went to Celestin Omeya. I have met Peter Odili. Peter Odili, one in one, has told me in confidence, he said, look, he would never do things that will take anybody's life.
that is looking for a reconciliation. Most times, Peter Odili will call for reconciliations, and because it may be the name, the title that he was militant, and so on. Asare would tell his people, we won't go because we are not criminals, we are not cultists. So most of the people at that time has already joined Alhaji Asare Tokubo to fight the Ateke groups. So when there is a meeting, Asare's group will not want to identify with Ateke groups. So it was difficult for Odili to solve the problem.
Oh, yeah.
It now came to Celestine Omeya. Celestine Omeya was eager, he wants to solve the problem. On the process, he now said, if you repent as a cultist, the government will give you 1 million naira.
Okay.
I said, can you give people who are not schooled, who does not understand what they will do with the money, who are killing people because of money, who are doing several things, 1 million naira, then it means you're going to worsen the whole of the situation. The government did not listen to me. That was why the routine went LY. Everybody, the commissioner of police then will call me, say, Eric Osima, I'm in trouble. I have 50 lists. Somebody will write to him, say, I have 50 boys. We are all militants, we have repented. We need our 50 million thousand. To them, this is the problem. You cannot do that. Now, that was where a lot of people now were like, if you want to be a militant, if you want to be a cultist, they will send you, go and kill somebody, go and do this one, then you become a militant. So people who were never cultists, now started going to identify themselves with leaders. Leaders who now send them in errors to kidnap, to do several things. That's how the thing spread. Then late Azazi was chief of defense staff or that. He called me in Abuja. Said, what is wrong in Port Harcourt? What do we do? I told him, look, even the hand of the government is tight. The best we can do right now is a state of emergency. I told Azazi. On the day he was to go to Port Harcourt, I was with him in Abuja in his house. He went to Port Harcourt and they now declared curfew. It got worse. Because these things were not just fighting the system. They were not. They were killing themselves. If I see your boys, I will kill. If you see my boys kill, we must know who is more superior. That's how the war was.
Okay.
Until the court, on the process, now brought in Emeshi. When Emeshi came in, nobody was looking for any particular militant leader in the whole of Niger Delta. No government has declared anybody wanted. So they were not looked for. They were free until Amishi came in and declared 3 people wanted. So Boma George, Farad Abdugo, and Ateketon. When he declared it wanted, the whole place was tensed. So on the 1st of January 2008, Ateke attacked a police station and a presidential hotel and so on with his boys. On the 1st of January. On the 2nd, I was the only person that was called by the radio station in Port Harcourt, Reading. And I condemned the attack. I said, you can't be killing policemen. Killing a policeman is like stripping the society naked. Mm. I condemned the attack and Ateke heard it in the creek. I've never met Ateke before. He heard it and said, who is that person who has condemned what he did? I said, that he wants to see me. I said, me too, I want to see you. This is on the 2nd. On the 3rd, he sent somebody to me. The person carried me to waterside, put in a boat, until we went to Ateke's camp. And Ateke said, look, I must refute what I have said. I am telling you how God has been with me.
Mm.
Because the Ateke term at that time, no normal human being with the impression we heard about this man will go to him. I went to him, I said, you can't be killing policemen. He said, no. That I must refute what I have said. I said I will not refute it because I know that that period, there was this thing that he was doing sports programs in his place, Okoshiri. So why would you now kill policemen? So he now told me his story.
Okay.
Say, the government of Amechi has attacked his village, Okoshiri, which is one of the biggest towns in Okrika. Okoshiri is not a camp, it's a town. That Amishi has attacked Okoshiri, attacked his house, they packed his monies in thousands, then killed people, packed all that he had, and nobody heard it. So out of annoyance, out of let people hear that something has happened to me, and people are wanting to kill me for nothing, I retaliated.
Okay. Did you give him any sort of advice on how to seek redress?
He said I retaliated. I'm just coming on the story. Mm-hmm. When he said I retaliated, I said, okay, but this is not the way I now told him about non-violence. He said, look, Ateke told me, these people are alive. I want people to ask questions. Ateke told me, nobody has come here to tell me about non-violence. Everybody that comes here tells me, if you don't fight back, the government will say they have warned you. I said, you don't need to fight back. I then called the commissioner of police. He picked my phone and I told him, I am with Ateke Tom. And this is what has happened. Ateke Tom, I want you to talk to him. I gave my phone to Ateke Tom and Ateke Tom talked to the policeman. And he said, he's sorry to him. Ateke Tom called media from there and said, I have believed this man, Eric Osima, and I believe he's non-violent. From there, Ateke Tom said, I repent. That's where the amnesty and begging for forgiveness started.
Right.
I now started going down to the chairman. I went around to the whole of the chairman. I went to Guguma chairman. I went to Boni. I went to Okrika. I was like, let us forgive this our people. Let's talk to the governor. By the time we forgive them and they come on board, we can use them. The chairman was scared because at that time, the governor does not like my face or maybe does not want my belief. What I believed was different from what he believes. He believes that these people must be killed. And I'm saying, no, forgive them. So the chairman was scared. I went to the chief chief media of the governor, and I talked to him. He said, look, if you will accept it, I believe you, but I don't believe this other voice you're talking about. And I now said, okay, I brought an agreement from Ateke Tom that he has accepted peace. He's ready to lay down his guns. I brought it to him for us to follow up and get to the governor. By the time we get to the governor or something, the whole story changed, and they said they can never do it.
Okay.
So the governor now went on the process, and there was a truth and reconciliation.
Okay. We had truth and reconciliation at that time. And
when
a number of people came out and decided to say what had been bothering them.
If you remember that program, on the first day was me and the governor. When the governor formed the truth and reconciliation, before that truth and reconciliation, I have met the governor. I met him in Abuja, in Transcorp PLC. I said, His Excellency, these things can be solved. I have met Ateke Tom. I have met Farah Dagogo. I have met these boys. I have met Suboma George. They are ready to lay down their guns. The governor said he will not forgive. That if it were me, they killed my people, will I be asking him for forgiveness? I said, no, even Saul was Saul. God made him to become Paul. I begged the governor. He said he will not. I said, he now asked me, do I want to tell him that I know God more than him? Up to then, I said, I brought out my form, my NGO's form. I said, I want you to be part of my NGO. He said, yes. It was 200 naira to be part of my NGO. He collected the form.
That's the foundation for peace.
Then it was Niger Delta Non-Violent Movement.
Okay, Niger Delta.
That was the name God I used. Okay. But Nigeria refused to register it, whatever reason.
Okay.
He collected the form. So on the day of the Truth and Reconciliation, when he came out, I insisted I would be inside there. I went inside. And there was time for questions. So I asked him, I said, His Excellency, I have met you before asking for forgiveness for these boys, and you refuse. It was done in the open. He was mad. He said, I am one of them because I knew them. That in short, they should arrest me. And I was like, you want to arrest me because I am preaching peace? The judge, who is now late, told him, His Excellency, we cannot arrest. Before then, I have met the Senate President, David Mark. And I talked to him about this thing, about the peace and all that I am doing. David Mark promised that he was coming to see Ateke Tom without security.
Mm.
David Mark came to River State. I am telling you because these people are alive. David Mark came to River State. On that day, I was with Ateke Tom because he was coming. We were to receive him. We waited till about 3 something. They now called Ateke Tom that the governor of River State wanted to come with David Mark. Ateke Tom said he would never let him come. I said, if you don't let him come, how would they know you want peace? So he said, okay, come. That day we waited, there was curfew. So by 6 o'clock, the boats wouldn't move. I waited till about 5. I had to leave. The following morning, Ateke called me. That there is a report everywhere that the government and David Mark has gone to discover his guns in Okoshiri. Okoshiri, where they have driven Ateke Tom. That he does not even know anything about those guns. So I even reminded...
The meeting never took place.
The meeting never took place. So I ran down back to Abuja. I went back to David Mark and said, what is happening? How come this story that you are supposed to see us has now turned to you and the governor going to discover Ateke guns? The man told me, I am a retired soldier. He said, I do not fear anybody. But I'll tell you the truth. He said, if I have insisted in going, they would have killed me and said it was Ateke boys that killed me. I said, ah. He said, but why have you reached that? He said he wants to reach Ateke Tom. And I begged him. I said, can I own my... He said, go. I owned my phone in his office. And I called Ateke Tom. And I gave him the phone. David Mark said to Ateke Tom, my brother, you know that I want to see you. But the government said, if I insist, my safety is not in their hand. So I turned back. That was how that peace thing went somewhere. So I now discovered that this thing, they don't want it and they want to kill these people. I started coming up to the vice president at that time, who is a vice president, Goodluck. By the time I go to his special advisor, I told him, I said, this is the program. All I'm asking for is forgiveness, amnesty. Amnesty would not have come in any way because nobody was looked for. But I said, if you give me this forgiveness, these people are ready. I showed all the facts. I brought it in one sheet of paper. The special advisor drove me out of his house. Because I later came to discover that he had a proposal for 60 years to solve the Niger Delta problem. 60 years. And I'm bringing a proposal for 6 months. Okay. I am telling you, I went through hell. But all of these things did not really matter to me. Because before I started this thing, I have gone to church to pray. And I say, God, remove fear from me. Somebody has to do it. I'm a family man. I risked the life of my family. I risked the life of my friends. I was called militant. I bared it. I said, these are my brothers. I said, these are my friends. We can't be killing people every day. So we went on. When the Truth and Reconciliation now came, I repeated these things. I said, you even want that the government wanted to kill David Mark. It was then the governor got angry on that program. I said, if it were me, they killed my people, will I tell him to forgive? Then I was asking for amnesty. This is how these things went. So when I went trying to see Goodluck, whom I have known very well, when they attacked Goodluck's house, when he became vice president, I know him so well that Goodluck called me. I'm saying this since because they are alive. Okay. Called me and said, Director Sima, can you help me find out? They know me as a peace man. They know me as somebody who is trying to mediate between all of these things. And that's who I am. Goodluck called me and said, what is happening? People have attacked my house. But I find out, I called and I called him back. But when I started this amnesty thing, my Ijaw brothers, my Ijaw elders, so many of them felt that I am just trying to betray the Ijaw people. That I want to tell the Ijaw, I want to take the Ijaw gun to government. They never believed it. They fought it. Some people said it can never be that amnesty is for condemned criminals. And I said, no, the amnesty I was asking for, God said we should put on the mind of Christ. And God told us, said, our strength is in our ability to forgive. That I am talking about God's forgiveness. The name amnesty came in because you had illegal guns that you've carried. The world will not just understand if I say forgiveness. So amnesty has to come. That's how we started in campus for amnesty. When I went to Aso Rock, because I have met this special advisor to Mr. President on Niger Delta, who has driven me out of his house. There are people at the gate who broke protocol to take me to people like OCSSS and so on, just to make sure, because I told them my programs. They said, this is beautiful. They said they were happy for me. I broke into seeing the vice president. By the time I go to the vice president, I was just in the vice president's office. Somebody will come. The next minute, they won't let me see him again. So they blocked me not to see Mr. Vice President. That was why I said, how do I get to Mr. President? Okay. By the grace of God, one young man in Slate introduced me to civil defense. Civil defense. It was through the civil defense we went to Mr. President.
Well, you sold him the idea of amnesty?
Yes. It was there. It was in the civil defense. They sent people, representatives, everybody came there. There was a video. They were taking all the records. I will call Ateke Tom. I will call Soboma George. At that time, even to answer the call that I have called Ateke Tom, say, please answer the call, they were shaking. I gave them all the contacts. They started reaching out to these people. That is how we begged for amnesty. When amnesty was to come, the River State government arrested me for a traffic offense that I did not even commit. That I took one way on the east-west road. So when we went to court, they said... is a traffic court, so you can defend yourself. They brought a video, had a video that I took one way. I actually did not take one way. The people there were looking for something. I drove to them and said, no, instead of delaying this man, why not just, so they were like, do you want to tell us what to do? They now went to the court and turned the story upside down. And I told the judge, before the judgment, that if this thing is confirmed to be lie, I will sue them. He said, no problem. Okay. They brought the video and played the video before the judge. And he saw that all they were saying were lies. He now said I should go and pay for the demurrage that my car has stayed there. And I should go. I said, I don't like your judgment. He got angry that I have challenged his government and gave me a bench warrant. That was in September. Amnesty was to end in October 4th.
Yeah.
That the condition for me to come out is that I must say sorry. I didn't know God was taking me to another place. They took me to prison, where I now met other militants. People like Orinemi Hart, who were in the prison till Amnesty got finished. What I demanded from Yeradua, what I asked him, the conditions we talked about, was to release those major people who had carried guns, who are in the prison.
Okay.
Like Orinemi Hart, Egberi Papa, this man in South Africa now, Henry Oka. I gave the conditions for their release. Asari Dokubo's name was, I gave Asari Dokubo's name in the amnesty because I know what I went through when he was in prison, and I understand that his case is still in court.
Okay.
So I said, look, remove the case from court and that. So I fix all those names there. That was what happened. So on the process, when I was in prison, I was like, I can't be, the condition is that I must say sorry to come out from prison. When I went there, I met other people. And I went, the whole world, it was in papers. Why am I in prison? So okay. The whole world, people were worried and a lot of things were happening. And along the line, I discovered that amnesty will soon expire. And Ateke Tom has not come out. When I was in prison, Suwoma George called me in prison. There's a way we have phones in prison.
Right.
And I told him, no, you must come out. He was the first person. I said, you must come out because they are trying to see what people will do. Don't nobody should react. You cannot react because I'm in prison. And so he came out. Now, I have to come out. For I have to say sorry. I have to be forced to say sorry because Ateke Tom has not come out.
All right. All this while, the program had gone on. And like you said, even in prison, you had your network where you could receive communication.
Very well.
Now, at that time, the program had started. Were you impressed with the response?
Now, did let me you tell you see, what happened now.
Because there have been talk that at the time the amnesty program kicked off, many of the people who had repented had not surrendered their guns, and that only a small fraction. Did you see that response as encouraging?
Yes, now look at what happened, my brother. By the time I came out, I called the civil defense. I said, what is happening? Why am I not?